Good morning.
May it please the court, I'm Andrea Schmidt here on behalf of the farmworker appellants in this case, and I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal if I could. And I also want the court to know that I'm hearing impaired, and I wear hearing aids that mostly correct my impairment, but it's going to be important that everybody speaking speak into the microphone. And I already consulted with Mr. Drake about that, so I think we should be all right. The Department of Labor's violation of its own regulations in the past is having an ongoing and devastating effect on Washington farm workers. And before I get into the language of that regulation and the harm that DOL's abandonment of that regulation is causing, I want to make sure that the court understands three important things. The first thing is that DOL admits that the prevailing piece rates are higher than the AWER, that's that H-2A minimum hourly wage, when it says that workers can earn more working at the piece rates than they can at the AWER. And second, because the H-2A program protects workers on a market level, we don't have to know whether every single worker will in fact earn more than the AWER when working at a piece rate to know that those piece rate wages are higher for the purposes of this regulation. And it's important to remember that these contracts under the H-2A system are not individually negotiated contracts. These are contracts that are market protectors and market testers, and they operate on a farm by farm and on a market level, not on an individual level. The third thing I want the court to remember is that current and remediable harm is happening because of DOL's past violations of these regulations. So, to talk about the regulatory language, the language at issue is...
Sorry, could you explain that third point a little bit more? What is the current harm that's following from the past violations?
So in 2023, DOL unlawfully approved 162 clearance orders affecting about 31,000 farm workers. So that's about a third of the hand harvest workforce in Washington that violated this regulation. The unlawful wages that were paid under those unlawfully approved clearance orders will now be reported on the prevailing wage survey that the state of Washington does. Actually, it's already been done. This prevailing wage survey happened at the end of 2023. Those prevailing wages are being calculated by the Washington Employment Security Department, which is the state workforce agency that works with DOL. And what they do is release those findings in the late spring or the early summer. So as we speak, the prevailing wages that are going to control for 2024 are being calculated based on input, tainted input, from last year's prevailing wage survey. Because DOL allowed improperly depressed wages to be paid last year.
So you would like us to tell DOL that they can't use those surveys because of the tainted data. What would they use instead?
They don't have to throw out the surveys entirely. We've identified the improperly granted job orders. We've put in the record a massive declaration that does that. What they have to do is to tell DOL that they can't use improperly granted AWER-only wages from these growers in calculating those prevailing wages. And when ESD does this survey, it knows who's responding. It can match a clearance order or a job order that's been improperly granted, and it can tell whether somebody is reporting having paid, for example, the AWER-only in a certain kind of apple because they were allowed to do so unlawfully by DOL.
Let me follow up on that.
Yes.
So I kind of think of this case as you're arguing that, in a sense, the recipe that they're going to use going forward at a restaurant is bad. It's a bad recipe, and you want the recipe to be accurate. Normally, in that situation, we would wait until someone orders the food at the restaurant to complain about how the food is being cooked. So I guess what I'm asking here is that do we have, I don't know, mootness and rightness at times? I get kind of confused as to which is which. But two questions. One, is this the time to be complaining about rates that have not been put into effect yet. And then second, and we're going to have questions, I'm sure, for opposing counsel about this DOL regulation change. In light of those two things, I'm just trying to understand, why is it now, why is this lawsuit about last year the one to determine what should be the recipe for this next year?
The data set that is used to calculate, it's not the recipe. The food is rotten. The ingredients are rotten. Okay. The data set that is used to calculate the prevailing wage findings for 2024 is tainted by the fact that DOL allowed unlawful wages to be paid. And not just a small number of them, but a huge number. I mean, we reviewed 192 relevant, the 192 relevant clearance orders, and 162 of them had this problem. That's an astounding number. So that the ingredients being used to make the food are bad, and we know it, right? The process of calculating the prevailing wages for this year is tainted by the bad input.
When you said that the state knows which order is which number, do they communicate that in the survey in the way that the federal government could then take some of it out, or do they need the state to help them figure out which things to take out?
The federal government would likely need the state to help them. They would need to say, hey, you have the raw data. The raw data includes the name of the grower who's responding on the survey. And they can look at those and say, did this person report having paid the AWER in an activity that had a published prevailing wage, in an activity that had a wage that was required to be paid that was higher than the AWER last year?
And so do we have a problem that the state isn't here? Like, how do we know that the state will do what the federal government asks it to do?
The state is a defendant in this case, but they aren't participating in this part of in this appeal. The state is a contractor with DOL. The state is acting pursuant to the direction of the Department of Labor. The Department of Labor ultimately approves these wages. The state does some calculations and sends them over to the Department of Labor for approval. So the Department of Labor can direct the state to take out wages that have been vacated by this court, and it should.
So why don't we have a back wages claim in this case? There are 31,000 workers who have been underpaid 20 to 50%. Why is that not part of this?
Because the defendant is the Department of Labor, and this is an APA case, and the remedy is to vacate the action of the Department of Labor and to order it to tell the growers that they paid unlawful wages. That opens up the possibility that workers will receive back pay, certainly. There are a couple of mechanisms for that. There's already an administrative system in the H-2A program that subjects growers to debarment if they don't pay the correct wages. So they'd be subject to debarment. They could decide for themselves whether they'd like to pay. And then workers could seek legal counsel and try to enforce their rights themselves. We've already said that that's hard, and that's true, but some may be able to do it and may be able to send a message to the industry that back pay is the way to go to avoid further problems.
Let me ask a follow-up question on that. So from an Article 3 standpoint, just help me out, help me understand the injury that you are alleging that your clients suffered and how the relief you're asking for now would redress that injury.
Yes, so plaintiffs are U.S. workers who participate in the labor market, in the fruit harvest labor market in Washington. The statute and the regulations are designed to protect U.S. workers' wages from adverse effect. And the kind of standing we have in this case is competitor standing or opportunity standing. In fact, Judge Mendoza found that to be the case in the original preliminary injunction motion in this case. And so the harm to plaintiffs is that wages are pushed down in the market as a whole, and that U.S. workers have fewer opportunities to do the jobs that they used to do at market rates. So I think it may be helpful to talk about what happens with these job orders. When a grower applies to be part of the H-2A system, that grower submits a job order with the terms of the job. That job order is posted by the government and by the grower to try to recruit U.S. workers as a test of the U.S. labor market. Are there workers who are willing to do this job at these terms, on these terms? Workers look at that job order. They go to the WorkSource office in Washington, and they look at the job order, and they say, apple harvest at a flat $17.41 an hour, that's 30% lower than what I would make on the open market. This is not a job I'm willing to do, and I'm pushed out of that job. Now, that sounds kind of benign because the assumption is they're going to go somewhere else and find another job. But as the use of the H-2A system increases in Washington, and we've had a 1,000% increase in H-2A since 2008. So first year of my career as a farm worker advocate, there were about 2,000 H-2A workers. There are more than 35,000. So we're talking about more than a third of the hand harvest workforce at this point. These workers are not going to find real market wage rates in many places anymore. And that is a harm, in addition to the lowering of the wages across the market. The loss of opportunity at a certain wage is also a harm. And the organic statute is specifically designed to prevent that harm. It says we can't have adverse effect to U.S. workers' wages and working conditions as a result of the H-2A program, which is exactly why this regulation exists. And I think this is a good opportunity to talk about what those wage rates actually look like. So in 2022, which is the last year that we have worker declarations in the record, the AWER was $17.41 an hour. And that same year, the published prevailing piece rate for general apple harvest was $28.26 a bin. Now, bins are these big wooden boxes that workers pick apples into. And it's in the record, it's undisputed, that workers can pick about a bin an hour. So lucky for us, the math is easy. And workers should be making about $28.26 an hour working at the piece rate. If they're paid the AWER only, they're limited to $17.41. They lose $10, more than $10 an hour, and about 30% of their wages. Now, my client, Ramon Torres Hernandez, is not actually a person who was paid the AWER instead of a piece rate. What is he? He's a worker who participates in the local labor market, who wants to work for $28.26 an hour and not $17.41. And it becomes harder for him as a participant in the market to find a job that truly reflects that market wage. And I think it's extremely important for the court to understand that everybody in this case agrees that workers can earn more by the piece, that the piece rate gives the opportunity to earn more, and that the AWER is the wage floor for the H-2A program. DOL says it in its briefing. DOL says it all the time in the Federal Register. At 75 Federal Register 6892, DOL says the purpose of the AWER, therefore, was to create a floor on the prevailing wage. It's totally clear that the higher wage here is the prevailing wage. And these lower wages, when they're...
All right, can I ask a question? If the new regulation comes out tomorrow and it is what it was in the draft, would we be done?
No, Your Honor. Thank you for that question. So the case absolutely is not moot if the regulation comes out tomorrow. The new regulation finally fixes the problem going forward. But it is not going to fix the taint in the calculations for the 2024 prevailing wages, because it's not going to act retrospectively.
So you need us to order that DOL doesn't accept these surveys in order to fix that?
We need DOL to order that. We need you to order DOL that the wages that were unlawfully approved in 2023 are vacated for all purposes, including use in the future calculations or the current calculations of the prevailing wage survey. And, you know, that would also have the effect, of course, of allowing workers to collect back pay. Now, there could be a couple of mechanisms for that. The growers could pay voluntarily, or workers could seek some kind of a remedy. But
Do you want to reserve your time?
I do.
Very
Thank
well.
Thank you, Jana.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court, John Drake on behalf of the United States Department of Labor defendants. Your Honors, one of the most striking aspects of this case is that it arrives in this court in a rather convoluted procedural posture, and many of those procedural nuances implicate threshold jurisdictional issues that the court can and must address before turning to the merits of the plaintiff's argument. I'll start by attempting to bring some clarity to that procedural posture. The top line here is that although the appeal that we have in front of us today was taken from a final judgment entered by the district court, the posture of the appeal is much more akin to an appeal of a denial of a preliminary injunction motion. Now, to be clear, we do not dispute that this court has proper appellate jurisdiction under 28 U.S.C. Section 1291. But for reasons I'll explain, it really makes the most sense to view this appeal through the lens of a preliminary injunction appeal and to focus on the forms of relief that the plaintiffs are currently requesting. So the case initially arrived in this court on appeal from a denial of a preliminary injunction motion, as I said. That particular motion was the third PI motion that the plaintiffs filed over the course of nearly 3 years on a claim that they had asserted over 2 years earlier after DOL had moved.
Maybe let's cut to the chase. So your opposing counsel is arguing that the remedy on the table now is to order your client to not accept surveys that include the survey data that includes these wage orders that were based on the AWER instead of the piece rate. What is wrong with that remedy?
Several things, Your Honor. First and foremost is that the plaintiffs did not request this relief in the district court below. The plaintiffs did mention this theory that there would be a corruption of the wage survey results.
Well, at that point, they were trying to stop the original. I mean, you were before so it was still in progress at that point. So I think they were trying to keep the surveys from affecting what you approved, because at the time, that was what the effect would be. Now it's the same sort of thing. It's just after, right? I'm not sure that's, like, why would they anticipate that the litigation would take this long and so ask for the thing that would need to be later?
The best answer to that question, Your Honor, is that the plaintiffs filed this preliminary injunction motion halfway through the 2023 harvest season. So a lot of wages had already been paid at that point, right? And so the theory that this is all harm that's happening after the fact is not correct, because if plaintiffs are asking for this alleged corruption to be removed, the district court would have had to have gone back and said, okay, all those wages that have been paid prior to the date on which I hypothetically grant this motion need to be excluded from the prevailing wage survey. Now, I think it's also notable that the plaintiffs are now saying that this relief, excluding what they call AWER-only wages from the wage survey, is, quote, part and parcel of the relief that they requested below. But if that were true now, it would also have been true back at the time that the parties were in the district court. There's really no explanation why this request has been made on appeal when it wasn't requested below.
So what's your argument about, what remedy do you think they are entitled to seek here based on their appeal, assuming that we think that the underlying claim is meritorious?
Your Honor, the plaintiffs say in the reply brief that the relief they want first and foremost, above and beyond this relief that we're talking about now, is just a declaratory ruling that the department's interpretation of the regulation is wrong.
Right, and you think that we have authority to do that?
I think that you do from a procedural standpoint.
Are there any other remedies besides declaratory relief that you would agree the plaintiffs would be entitled to on this appeal if we ended up agreeing with them on the merits?
Not on this record, Your Honor, no.
And at the moment, the declaratory relief is not moot because the rule hasn't been promulgated, right?
That's right.
And what is the update on that?
Thank you, Your Honor. As we noted in our letter brief filed on March 6th, the rule is no longer in the proposed rule stage. The Department of Labor has submitted a final rule in draft form to the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, OIRA, which is an agency within OMB. The regulatory agenda on OIRA's website currently lists this month, April 2024, as the anticipated date by which that review will be completed. And so I think we are just weeks away from that.
So I could not tell from your letter whether what was forwarded to OIRA was the same as the draft rule that had been put out for notice and comment.
Correct, Your Honor. We deliberately did not include that information. It's not public. It's subject to the deliberative process privilege. I understand the reason why you're asking. I'm just not at liberty to explain what the draft rule contains.
But so at the moment, we have no reason to think that this is about to become moot because we don't even know if the regulation that you're wanting now is what they want.
I don't think that's quite correct. I think that the proposed rule is exactly what they want. And as counsel conceded, it's finally fixing the problem going forward. It's contingent, of course, upon the final rule mirroring what was in the proposed rule. I do agree with that. I think our point is that we are very close to that final rule being issued, and it makes more sense for the court to wait a matter of weeks to determine whether it is, in fact, the same as the proposed rule or if it is not.
Does OIRA have a mandatory deadline to consider this, or could it kick it?
Yes, they do, Your Honor. The executive order that establishes this review process says that OIRA has 90 days within which to issue a review decision, and that would be, I believe, late May on this record. But again, the regulatory agenda says that it's going to happen sooner. And so in furtherance of this discussion, I think it does make the most sense, given that what the plaintiffs really want, what they're asking for first and foremost, is a review of DOL's interpretation of the regulation.
Sorry, can I take you back to what they needed, what on your view they needed to argue in the district court? So usually when a case is, there's standing, there's jurisdiction when it starts, it's harder for a case to become moot than it would have been to like get it started in the first place. If there's any relief that is available, we're supposed to say the case is not moot. I'm not sure that that inquiry about whether any relief is available usually parses so finely what was asked for originally, because it's could any relief be given now? So why can't we look at the relief she's asking for now?
I agree, Your Honor, that the effective relief line of cases do say that it doesn't need to be parsed that finely. But the cases that the plaintiffs cite in their brief and the cases that you're referring to are materially different. Those cases address a situation in which the relief that the plaintiffs originally requested is no longer available as a result of events happening throughout the course of the litigation. And the plaintiffs are then turning to the next best available relief. That's not what we have here. The plaintiffs are not saying that the relief they originally requested is no longer available.
Well, I think they kind of are, because originally they were asking for you to not approve the 2023 work orders that had this flaw. That's impossible now because the 2023 work orders are done. So now they're saying at least don't consider those in the surveys that affect the 2024 wages. That seems like the best, closest thing. I'm not sure I understand your answer.
Well, to be clear, Your Honor, the plaintiffs still are asking for the same relief relative to the 2023 job orders. They are asking this court to vacate those job orders, retroactively vacate them.
Okay, and well, so maybe we can't exactly do that. Maybe we won't give them everything they want, but why couldn't we do the part of it that has to do with incorporating that data into the 2024?
Sure, and I think this is a good time to clear up some real confusion about what they're asking for relative to the exclusion of AWER wages. It is a critically important point that the plaintiffs in this case are not H-2A workers. They are not the foreign workers who are coming in on an H-2A visa and performing temporary agricultural work and then going back to their home countries. They are domestic workers, okay? And to Judge Owen's point earlier, the relief they are asking for at this point is to essentially order H-2A employers to pay back wages to H-2A employers.
No, no, they're asking for you to exclude this data from the 2024 orders that get approved so that they won't have foreign competitors getting paid too little.
Correct. That is what they're asking. The important point relative to the prevailing wage survey that the State Employment Security Department performs is that that survey is only capturing wages paid to domestic workers. Employers are not supposed to report wages that are paid to H-2A workers because that would confound the whole analysis. The idea is to get a survey of wages paid in the domestic labor market so that wages paid to H-2A employer or H-2A employees will not undercut those wages. And so this idea that the prevailing wage survey is going to be fundamentally corrupted is just not accurate. And this is addressed on pages 37 to 39 of our answering brief. There are about six different links in the causation chain that would have to happen for the corruption that they're talking about to occur, each one more and more attenuated. And most importantly, it would have to happen on such a pervasive scale that these corrupt wages are determined to become the prevailing wage for the entire crop activity. Now, I think to Judge
Owens... So I think their theory must be that the domestic workers for some of these farms that had these orders where they were able to pay the foreign workers lower than what they say they should have, that the domestic workers were also paid that. That must be part of their theory, right? Are you saying that didn't happen?
I don't think that's what they are saying, Your Honor, and we addressed this in our briefing. The plaintiffs have not shown that any domestic U.S. workers were working for the same employers that are paying these H-2A workers H-2A wages. Had domestic workers been working alongside H-2A workers in what's called corresponding employment, that employer would have been required to pay the same wage to both sets of workers. But on this record, there's just no evidence that that, in fact, occurred. And it's fatal, frankly, to their Article III standing to pursue these additional forms of relief that we're talking about.
So are you saying then that what your colleague argued with respect to 31,000 workers being paid 20 to 50% less, 162 employers not following the appropriate prevailing wage regulation, are you saying that's just not true?
I'm saying it's pervasively misleading, Your Honor, and let me explain why. The number of workers that the plaintiffs are saying are impacted, some 31,000, is based upon the total number of workers in the aggregate that these H-2A employers sought labor certifications for. So those job orders, importantly, are not typically just for one crop activity. They are covering many, many, many different activities, from harvesting, which we're concerned with in this case, to pruning, to thinning trees, et cetera, and of course cover all different types of crops, apples, berries, oranges, et cetera. The easiest way to illustrate this point is by using an example from the declaration that opposing counsel referenced earlier. At 2 ER 78, there is a job order that was submitted by Upland Farms. This is paragraph 23 of the Hernandez-Jimenez declaration. There's a hyperlink there, and you need to click it. But when you click that job order, you'll see that it covers 227 workers. The employer is saying, I have enough work to keep 227 workers busy. I will try to get those workers from the domestic labor pool, but if I can't, I need to hire H-2A workers to fill that, to fill those spots. The job order covers 36 different crop activities, from harvesting to thinning to pruning of cherries, pears, grapes, etc. The plaintiffs in this case are focused on one of those 36 crop activities, harvesting of Rainier cherries in this example. The other 35 activities that are covered by that job order are not at issue, and under plaintiff's theory were properly approved. And so it's really not accurate to say that that particular job order or all the job orders that they've cited are impacting 227 workers, because obviously not all 227 of those workers are performing that one single crop activity out of the 36. And relatedly, the plaintiffs say in their briefing that almost 85% of fruit harvest job orders submitted for the state of Washington were unlawfully approved. Along the same lines, they're counting that entire job order in the example I just mentioned as having been unlawfully approved, even though only one of the 36 crop activities covered by that job order is implicating this issue that we're talking about. And so I think it is important to drill down on that. This is not something that was addressed in the district court because, again, the proceedings were very superficial on a preliminary injunction motion, addressed primarily to the preliminary injunction factors, primarily whether the plaintiffs were facing irreparable harm. And so these are the types of issues that would have been fleshed out had the case continued in the district court.
So if what you're, I'm pretty confused, I must admit, because I thought they were saying there are workers side by side. You're saying there aren't. I mean, what if we say they're right about the statute and if it's possible to parse these job orders out of the surveys, that would be a remedy that would keep this from being moot and then send it back to the district court to figure out who's right about whether workers are side by side and whether it can be parsed. Is there any problem with that?
I think the first problem is that on the current record, it's not possible, because while it is theoretically possible for domestic workers to be working in corresponding employment with H-2A employers, there is no evidence of record in this case to establish that that has happened. So the plaintiffs could have filed declarations saying, I work for Upland Farms. They employed me and 10 other U.S. workers in addition to 217 H-2A workers. But there is no evidence along those lines. If the court is inclined to have these nuanced issues fleshed out, I do think it would be most appropriate for the district court to do that. Because it is important, of course, to have a developed factual record. And it's also important to note, let's not forget that what the plaintiffs are requesting here in the way of forward-looking relief is mandatory injunctive relief. And that's subject to a doubly demanding burden under this court's precedent, the Garcia v. Google case that we cited in our briefing. And it's frankly not appropriate use of judicial resources for this court to engage in that sort of analysis with that high evidentiary burden on a record that's not fully developed. I'd like to turn just briefly to the other new form of relief that plaintiffs are seeking on appeal, and that's the payment of back wages. And I use that as a shorthand. What the plaintiffs are really asking is for this court to order the Department of Labor to require H-2A employers to go back and pay.
It didn't really sound like your opposing counsel was asking for that today, as I understood her argument.
I agree that it was not covered by her argument. However, it is something that they requested in their briefing. And so I think it's important to note that, again, plaintiffs did not request this relief below. And in fact, they expressly disclaimed any intent to pursue payment of back wages in the district court. They said they had no practical path to obtain this relief and that it would not remedy their harm in any event. And they said that in connection with each of the three different preliminary injunction motions that were filed, 3 ER-401, SER 164 to 165, and SER 55. So this relief has been clearly waived by expressly conceding that they're not seeking it. But it's a little more sinister than that, frankly, because the plaintiffs made a strategic decision not to request this relief. They actually convinced the district court to issue a preliminary injunction based on that argument back in March of 2021. And so the fact that the plaintiffs are saying, we can't get this relief, that's why we need injunctive relief now, the district court agreed with them, and they're now taking the opposite position on appeal, is frankly a classic judicial estoppel problem. In the short time that I have remaining, I will just note that what we're talking about here is a small corner of the prevailing, or excuse me, of the H-2A regulations. It is not the case that prevailing wage rates are always validated at a piece rate prevailing wage. It's more common for them to be hourly wages. And when the piece rate wage is an hourly wage, it's an easy comparison to the AWER, which is always an hourly wage. Compare the two numbers, whichever is higher. We have here a unique circumstance where prevailing wage rates are, in some cases, validated at a piece rate wage, which has the potential to yield higher wages. And the Department of Labor, again, is in the process of amending the regulation to reflect that those wages ought to be offered in the job order. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, counsel.
Your Honors, I want to first correct the statement that workers filed this motion after the harvest season. Workers filed this motion during the first harvest season, which was cherry, and certainly well before cherry ended and before pear and apple harvest happened. Judge Owens, I want to go back to a question you asked, which is, aren't we too early to be challenging bad findings? We need a declaration that DOL's actions here were unlawful and those wages that they approved were unlawful if we're going to challenge the bad findings in the future. So this court should not wait to say that DOL at a minimum has been violating this regulation when it has been approving these wages, because that's what we would need in order to challenge bad wages when they come out. Now I wanna talk about this interplay between domestic workers and H-2A workers. It is the duty of an H-2A employer and the duty of the government to recruit as many U.S. workers as possible under a job order before allowing for H-2A workers to be brought in. Corresponding workers, U.S. corresponding workers, do work on these farms. And the survey instrument that ESD uses to do this survey asks employers to answer the questions as to its non-H-2A workers, but as to the other workers who work on its farm. If the employer is an H-2A worker, excuse me, an H-2A employer, that employer pays the same wage to H-2A workers and corresponding workers. And so, when that employer answers the questions about what wages it has paid for the year, that employer says that it has paid those wages that were included in the H-2A contract even to its domestic workers. That's how
the government is saying you haven't shown any evidence that the particular farms had both types of workers. So do you have a response to that? I mean, you're saying in general this is how it should be, but is there evidence?
That there isn't specific evidence in the record. It is how the system works. Any employer who is using any H-2A workers is required to actively recruit U.S. workers. We have a robust U.S. workforce in Washington among farm workers. Now, it is possible that there is a farm that recruited no U.S. workers. This is possible. It is unlikely that is the case because the system doesn't work that way. And we don't have to know whether each farm actually had corresponding workers to get effective relief to the market harm here. This court can order that the AWER-only wages, the improperly approved AWER-only wages, are rescinded in those job orders. And then ESD can parse the data. ESD knows the name of the employer who answered the wage question, and it knows the activity for which that employer is answering the question, and it can see whether that employer is answering using the AWER or some other piece rate or some other wage, hopefully the prevailing piece rate, right? And it can remove AWER-only answers for an employer who was in fact required to offer a prevailing piece rate in that job order in the first place. Now, we don't have to know exactly who those employers are to know that we are securing the integrity of the data by doing that, by making that order. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you very much to both counsel for their briefing and argument in this case. This matter is submitted, and a couple of us will be back tomorrow. Thank you again, Judge Orrick, for
You're welcome.
Very appreciated. And for those who are going to be attending the functions later today, stay tuned. We have some guest speakers who I think are going to be speaking to you while we conference.